This bulletin, the Victorian Aboriginal Community Controlled Health Organisation, outraged by government's potential backflip on raising the age of criminal responsibility. Independent M-P Kylea Tink to introduce a bill to limit the time asylum seekers can spend in immigration detention. And ministerial powers to place a division of the CFMEU into administration could be put in place within days. The Victorian Aboriginal Community Controlled Health Organisation, VACHO, says it is deeply concerned the Victorian government is abandoning its plan to raise the age of criminal responsibility to 14. Children as young as 10 can be charged with, convicted and imprisoned across Australia, except in the Northern Territory, which raised the age of criminal responsibility to 12 in August 2023. The ACT passed legislation to raise the age to 14 by 2025, with some exceptions, while Tasmania has pledged to raise the minimum age of criminal detention to 14. The Victorian government had originally planned to then raise the age to 14 by 2027, but following a series of prominent incidents involved alleged youth offenders, including two fatal car crashes, the government has decided to dump that move. The CEO of the Victorian Aboriginal Community Controlled Health Organisation, Dr. Jill Gallagher, implored the state government to abandon a reform that she said would have positive impacts to the health and well-being of First Nation children and their families.
Our burais, meaning our children, belong in schools, not in juvenile detention and at the mercy of the criminal justice system. We know that interactions with the criminal justice system not only stigmatises young people, but also sets them on a path and cycle of recriminalisation. This contributes to the intergenerational trauma and perpetuates cycles of disadvantage within Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander families in Victoria. In June, Premier Allan bravely announced that as a mother, her government would introduce a pill testing trial to safeguard the health, well-being and lives of young people. Again, I ask the Premier to think as a mother to protect our burais from being ripped away into a system that rarely delivers rehabilitation, but rather sets them on a path on continued criminalisation.
Indigenous knowledge systems will be a focus of a revamped set of scientific priorities announced by the federal government. The new framework will see Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander knowledge incorporated into emerging technologies, particularly digital and data, while protecting their cultural and intellectual property. It replaces the current framework, which was published in 2015. The policy also calls for research to address the approach to climate change adaptation that supports regional and remote communities. The framework will also see research that affects Indigenous people, guided by them, whether as community leaders, traditional knowledge holders or researchers. Independent MP Kylea Tink will introduce a bill to limit the time asylum seekers can spend in immigration detention. The bill would make it illegal for the Australian government to detain asylum seekers for more than 90 days and to place any children in detention centres. Ms. Tink claims the Migration Amendment Bill 2024 will ensure Australia complies with global human rights obligations. She says Australia does not meet international standards when it comes to treatment of asylum seekers.
As it currently stands, we are one of the only nations in the world that receives asylum seekers and refugees, promptly offshores them and puts them into facilities with very little transparency or accountability and holds them indefinitely, with no line of sight for that human being on what sort of treatment they can expect to receive or when they will be released.
The construction union is set to be put through a minimum 3-year administration period under a tentative agreement struck between Labor and the coalition following corruption allegations. Legislation to appoint an external administration to the CFMU construction arm has been stalled in the Senate after the opposition refused to support the bill without concessions on a minimum period and donation bans. Negotiations are continuing after the Coalition and Greens on Thursday teamed up to block the bill from being passed before the weekend. A final agreement hadn't been reached as of Monday morning, Workplace Relations Minister Murray Watt said, but a number of coalition amendments had been agreed to. A group of Australians is calling on the government to do more to uphold international humanitarian law after the deadliest year on record for aid workers. The 60 signatories, including humanitarian aid organisations and former politicians, have called on the government to ensure accountability when there are breaches to the Geneva Conventions on World Humanitarian Day. Almost 300 aid workers were killed in 2023, more than double the death toll in 2022. Chief Executive of Oxfam Australia, Lynn Morgan, says it has never been more dangerous to provide aid.
What we know is that the humanitarian cause has never, ever been so challenged by the lack of respect for the rule of law. So we know for Oxfam in Gaza that as recently as July, a kilometre from where our staff are working to provide life-saving aid, 80 humanitarians were murdered.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has announced plans to create a buffer zone in Russia's Kursk region. Ukraine has destroyed a key bridge in the region and struck a second one nearby, disrupting Russian supply lines during a cross-border incursion that began on the 6th of August. In his nightly address, Mr. Zelensky says Ukraine's primary task in defensive operations is to destroy as much Russian war potential as possible and conduct maximum counteroffensive operations. This includes creating a buffer zone in the operations in the Kursk region.
Today, we achieved good and much-needed results in destroying Russian equipment near Turetsk. And all this is more than just defense for Ukraine. It is now our primary task in defensive operations overall to destroy as much Russian war potential as possible and conduct maximum counter-offensive actions. This includes creating a buffer zone on the aggressor's territory, our operation in the Kursk region.
Doctors Without Borders says people who have fled war-affected Sudan for neighboring Chad are facing a starvation crisis. Recent rains have led to the collapse of a key bridge in South Darfur, making it near impossible for large amounts of aid to reach the area. The nation was plunged into chaos last year when tensions between the Sudanese armed forces and the Rapid Support Forces paramilitary group turned into open fighting in the capital, Khartoum, before spreading across the country. Tamama Laudat, who works for Doctors Without Borders in South Darfur, says the starvation crisis is critical.
There have been kids in therapeutic feeding center where we received children with malnutrition who were above 1 year old, who looked like they are 4 or 5 months old. They can't walk. There's a chronic malnutrition that is compounded now by acute malnutrition. Children are in, and it's very difficult to treat them because parents cannot afford to come every week to get that therapeutic food that they need.
Diplomats from the United States, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, the United Arab Emirates, the African Union and the United Nations have been trying to restart talks aimed at calming the fighting in the East African country. And almost a decade after Australia's biggest public transport project was initially proposed, the Sydney Metro has officially opened today. As part of the $21 billion project, a new metro line will operate under Sydney Harbour between Chatswood and Sydenham, connecting the booming northwest region to the CBD. The first metro train service of the new section departed Sydenham Station at 4:54 a.m. this morning, reaching Chatswood Station by 5:16 a.m. New South Wales Transport Minister Joe Halen is asking people to be careful amid the excitement of the opening.
Don't run for the doors, and we don't want you separated from your travelling companions. Parents and carers, hold your kids' hand, because you don't want them on one train and you on another.
The aim is to have ultimate capacity for a metro train every 2 minutes in each direction under the city. And to sport, workers in Paris have begun to convert the Eiffel Tower Stadium pitch to host the Paralympic blind football events. The Paralympics, which bring together nearly 4,500 athletes, will begin on August 28, with the opening ceremony set to happen on the Champs-Élysées and the Concorde Square. Venue manager for the Paris 2024 blind football, Gauthier Jourdet, says 400 tons of sand will allow for better acoustics of the playing field for the visually impaired athletes.
The players are guided a lot by sound, sound coming from bells inside the ball and also by the guides that are outside the field of play. And so for that, it is extremely important that the field itself has good sound absorption capacities. That's why it's important to keep sand under the blind football playing area to avoid any resonance effects.
The blind football events will begin at the foot of the Eiffel Tower on September 1, with a final scheduled for September 7th. And now having a look at the weather around the country, Broome, sunny day, 28 degrees, Perth, a shower to 19, Adelaide, showers increasing, 20, Melbourne, partly cloudy, 19, Hobart, much the same, 13 degrees, Albury-Wodonga, partly cloudy, 17, Canberra, similar conditions, and 15, Wollongong, partly cloudy, 17, Sydney, much the same, 18, Newcastle, similar conditions, and 19 degrees, Brisbane, partly cloudy day, 23, Townsville, partly cloudy as well, and 27 degrees, Cairns, sunny 29, Alice Springs, similar conditions, 32, and Darwin, also sunny, 32 degrees, and the Torres Strait Islands, a mostly sunny day ahead and a top of 29 degrees. And that is NITV Radio News.